to appreciate the Thursday Music with Michael services that he's so faithfully put on in this COVID-19 period. And we're going to do something a little different this Thursday. We're going to talk to Michael about his experience in Vietnam, where he led two choirs and won a Bronze Star for his special work there. And we're going to play music mostly, but have some talk too. So, Michael, set the stage for us, if you would. It's 1969, and you are a young graduate student in music, is that right?
That's right.
And you had a small church that, where you did the music, but you were working on a construction crew when you got the word. What happened?
Well, I was a student at the seminary in Fort Worth, and I got my undergraduate degree in music, and I was working on a master's degree in church music at the seminary in Fort Worth. And in the summertime, just for extra money, I joined a construction crew. So I was out digging holes to build a, believe it or not, football stadium. So we were preparing for the concrete to come in for the football stadium. And they brought me the letter, and it was greetings from Uncle Sam. You are expected to report. And so from then on, as I reported to downtown Dallas, and was drafted into the Army in 1969. Did my basic training at Fort Polk in Louisiana in August, and that was before air conditioning was in any of the barracks, and I hated it.
And I think most incredible of all to those of us who love you, you were in the military police, is that right?
The Army in its wisdom decided that I would be a good policeman, so I went to Fort Gordon, Georgia, and was trained as a military policeman. Of all the things in the world that I would not be good at, but the odd thing about it is everything they trained you for in training, in AIT training, at Fort Gordon, we had to throw completely away when we got to Vietnam because we didn't use it. We learned how to direct traffic and write tickets and all the things like that that you think policemen might do, but we didn't do any of that in Vietnam, so it's kind of strange.
And you were in Vietnam for a full year, is that right?
I was there for 14 months. You automatically go for one for 12 months. And then if you extend, which I did, I signed the papers and I extended for 2 months. So I stayed an extra 2 months. So when I returned to the United States, I was out processed. I didn't have to do any stateside duty. Because I had a very good, very rewarding assignment finally in Vietnam.
That's right. You had two basic assignments, and the first was pretty tough, right?
The first was difficult. I was assigned to a military police unit that was on the Saigon River, just upriver from, downstream, downriver from Saigon, and there was a port called Cat Lai, and it was where all the ocean-going vessels came in because the river was that wide and deep there, so the ocean-going vessels could come into our port, and they would offload ammunition and then onto barges. And the barge, we would escort the barges up the river to all the various military installations all up and down the Saigon River. And at night, then we did patrol boats and protected the ships in the harbor from swimmers who might want to come out and attach a bomb. And we had a couple of bombs blow up, nothing spectacular, but yeah, it was.
Dicey, dangerous, too.
It was dicey. You know, get down, Mains. Those are bullets going over there. It's not fireworks. So that kind of thing.
And you did a little networking and got yourself reassigned. Is that right?
I did. I had a very dear friend that I went to college with who was in the replacement battalion there at Long Bend. And I called him and I said, get me out of here. We're finding bodies and we're getting shot at. So I need to use my music skills somewhere else. And so he managed to find a chaplain in Long Bend Post, and I was reassigned in to work. He was still in a military police unit, but he was a chaplain and a chaplain who served the Stockade, United States Army, Republic of Vietnam, USARV, Stockade, Long Bend Post. We affectionately referred to it as LBJ, Long Bend Jail.
Where was it? Near Saigon?
It's about 17, 18 miles north of Saigon on Highway 1, considered the kind of the most dangerous highway in the entire world.
let's hear some more music. Come now, fount of every blessing.
Great.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Raise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, good grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Now, we need you to explain how you came to lead not one but two choirs. Let's talk first about the free choir, the chapel choir.
Sure. Well, as it turned out, when I got to my position in at Long Bend, there was also a chapel outside of it. Referred to as a free chapel because they weren't prisoners. Anybody wanted to go to that chapel, and I have some pictures of that. You can we'll show those here for a while. Here is one of the songs. Very nice, beautiful chapel. Had a nice Hammond organ in it, believe it or not. And of course, there's nobody to play it, so they found out I could play the organ. So I got to join that chaplain in that chapel for a worship service every Sunday. And then I just said, well, let's put out the word, and if anybody wants to come sing, we'll have choir practice on Tuesday and Thursday night. And within just a few weeks, we had a good cadre of boys. We didn't have any girls. There were females on bass, but we didn't have any girls join the choir. But it's just a bunch of guys, and we practice, and we sing for worship service on Sunday morning.
And some of them had a background in music, and some of them didn't, I guess.
Most of them were pretty much neophytes. They were not professionally trained, but they were eager. And I managed to, we didn't have copy machines. I used a mimeograph at the time, so I hand wrote all the music that we sang. Occasionally, there would be a hymnal that would show up somewhere over there, but we weren't terribly well stocked as far as music went.
Well, let's hear another piece. How about Be Thou My Vision?
Okay, great.
Be Thou My Vision.
Thou my best God,
So what was your rank when you were leading this choir?
Well, of course, when I was drafted, so I went in as a private and advanced. When I got to Vietnam, I advanced to private first class immediately almost. And then by the time I out processed, I was what was called a specialist fifth class, which was equal to a three-star sergeant at the time. I don't think they even have specialists in the Army anymore. But in war zones, you know, you could make rank pretty quick. And so I left Vietnam as a specialist fifth class.
And were some of the men in your choir above your rank?
Yes, absolutely. They were sergeants. I didn't have any, I don't remember, I think maybe I had a captain or two, but some ward officers who were helicopter pilots and that sort of thing. But mainly it was just the enlisted men.
Right.
Yeah, not many officers.
And it was helpful to you personally to have this position as choir director. It gave you a little bit more in the way of privileges. Is that right?
It did. Once the word got out, and we also had a popular set of music that we'd sing, songs that reflected just having fun. We ended up singing at a lot of dinners for generals and colonels. They'd say, come over, can you get the choir over for such and such an event? And so we'd go sing for that. And so I hobnobbed with the generals, and I went and I visited several of their, they had very nice quarters.
Did you ever have to play the piano for their parties and things?
Oh, yeah. I played piano for all those parties and events. So.
Well, one of the secular tunes you performed was Blowing in the Wind.
And at the time, I didn't have a clue. I really wasn't in tune to the fact that that was kind of an anti-war sentiment song, but we sang it right
away.
We got away with it. And I didn't get my hands slapped or anything.
Let's hear the chapel choir sing Blowing in the Wind.
Outside, recorded on a little tiny cassette player.
Oh,
Well, you had some really good voices in the choir. Among the recorded music that survives is a soloist. Who was that?
Ted. His name is Ted Wiley. We went to school. He was the man that found me the chaplain position. And he was a voice major at our undergraduate school when we graduated. We were in the same class at OBU. And having just ran into him when I arrived in Vietnam, and he'd been there a few months. He's a trained voice major. He didn't sing with choir all the time, but on special occasions he would join us.
Well, you and he did a duet that I really like. Would you say the title of that and any background you have on that song?
Well, it's the old gospel hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me, and it was arranged and written by a dear friend of mine who was the head of the Baptist Music Foundation in Oklahoma at the time, Gene Bartlett. His father, whose first name I completely forgotten, Bartlett, wrote Victory in Jesus. So that was kind of his passport to staying in the Baptist circles for Gene. And he wrote this piece, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. And he sent me a copy of that while I was in Vietnam. And Ted and I sang that for one of our concerts.
Let's hear All the Way My Savior Leads Me.
At this time, I'll join Ted, and we'll sing a duet. It's a setting of an old hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. It was done by a very good friend of mine back in Oklahoma, Gene Bartlett. And I apologize, we only have one copy of the music, so we'll just...
Thank you.
And you introduced some of these songs, and what was striking to me is you sound exactly the same now as you did 50 years ago. Was it difficult to direct these men, or were they very happy to be part of this?
You know, it was a blast. It, when I finally left, they threw me a big party and gave me a goodbye gift. It was a lot of fun. We had a ball doing all the religious music and the pop stuff, and traveling to Saigon to sing concerts in various churches down there. So it was a very rewarding experience to know that. And these were the guys, we were all behind the lines. We weren't in it. None of these people were out fighting in the bushes. These were the secure people behind the scenes. I mean, we did take some mortar fire occasionally inside this base, but the Long Bend was the largest military installation in all of Vietnam. And so it was pretty well protected, but you know, we still have the same fears. We call them, and it's probably totally inappropriate, the Mama Sons and the Papa Sons, because they've got the carryover from World War II in the South Pacific. But we still call them that, politically incorrect today. But they would come in and do all our laundry and cleaning and ironing and everything, and we just knew that they were the ones who went out and put the black pajamas on at night and shot back at another troop. They may have been working for us in the day and Viet Cong at night. We didn't have any way of knowing that. So.
Well, let's talk about the Stockade Choir.
Yeah.
Now, whose idea was it that you might lead a choir of these men?
I don't know. It was mine, and it was may have been sort of foolhardy, but there was a little chapel. The Stockade was where any errant GIs all over Vietnam were sent if they got in trouble. Drugs, going AWOL. I mean, I even interviewed some guys who came in who had, were going up for murder. There was some of them who tossed grenades in their captain's tent and killed some of their own guys. So it was pretty intense. And that was part of my job, was to interview everybody and tell them what to expect every morning. When they came, the prisoners who came in overnight, I would in-process them.
That was your day job?
That was my morning job, every morning at 6 a.m. to talk to the guys who had come in overnight, tell them what to expect, how to get along in the stockade. And the stockade, as I said, LBJ, affectionately a Long Bend jail, was huge, many, many city blocks long, not a lot of amenities. The Green Berets, both sets of Green Berets came through. The second set came through while I was there, but they were cordoned off in a really, really very secure area. And I have pictures of that, which I'll show at some point in time, because all of those cells were made of Konex shipping crates. And those are great big metal 6x6x6, and they turned those into cages. Mm. And in the heat, it was miserable. A certain unmentionable magazine sent us word that if anybody could get a picture of one of those, they'd pay us $2,000. I snuck my camera into the stockade a few times, but I never could get my camera into the high security areas. So, I mean, the pictures that you'll see during some of the music here are pictures taken inside the stockade, which was totally forbidden, not supposed to happen, but somehow I managed to sneak my camera in.
Well, the men who sang in the stockade choir, did you just put out the word that you were organizing a choir?
Correct. And just, it just, as part of my spiel every morning when I would say, you know, you can come sing with us. We have a lot of fun singing. And I never knew who was going to be there. We practiced twice a week, Tuesday and Thursday in the afternoon. And we'd sing in chapel on Sunday morning. And then I'd walk across the street and sing and play for the other chapel. But, I mean, because the guys were coming and going, you know, based on their status of how long they were going to be in jail, if they were going to be shipped back to the States to be in jail, or if their JAG officer could get them off. So it never was the same group twice in a week.
Well, let's hear the Stockade Choir. I particularly like that he's got the whole world in his hands. So let's hear that.
The next number of the choir will present is spiritual, it's got the whole world.
Trained musician. I didn't have soul, and they let me know really quickly that there wasn't a, that they weren't happy with it. So I dug out some spirituals, and we sang lots of old spirituals, and they liked that a lot. We had a few Caucasians who would come to the choir practice, but by and large, it was mostly the African Americans who came to sing. And they had, some of those had fabulous voices, some terrific voices.
You have to have extra security for them for rehearsal, or
no?
No, they were free to come and just show up and sing.
Yeah.
And was discipline ever a problem, or were they there to enjoy themselves?
We did. I mean, their choices were they could, you know, there were a lot of work details they could be on, or they could come sing in the chapel choir. And they came, a lot of them chose to come sing, and we had a lot of fun. I mean, it really was fun in a prison. It's hard to imagine.
Let's hear another example from the Stockade Choir.
Now the choir does another spiritual, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, and Roland Morrell is our soloist on this one.
Forward to receive the Bronze Star for my work with the prisoners there. Both in processing them every morning, and then doing the choir and the music and things. And we did, we had little concerts in the prison choir. I would turn the chapel around and put the men up front to sing, and we had generals and colonels who'd come to those concerts and programs and listen to the boys sing.
So it wasn't just for services.
It wasn't only for services, even in the stockade. That's right. So, and some of the other things that I don't know, important, but while I was there, I got to where I was on the stage crew for Bob Hope, and we'll show some pictures of that too. And my job was to carry the film from the filming tower, the camera tower, backstage and put it in the refrigerator so it wouldn't melt. And in the days of real film, when you know, yeah. Real, it wasn't even video, it was film at the time. And I was I was a musical director for a play and a musical at some point in time for part of the USO. So I kept busy doing a lot of music stuff when I was there.
Were you political at all, or were you just trying to get through this?
I was trying to live through it, make the best of it. I was an old man when I was drafted. I was 25 when I was drafted. And most of the guys in my, you know, basic training units, and even the guys that I worked with in the military police units were 19, 20. They weren't very old.
But this was really the height of the U.S. participation.
1970.
The numbers were really big.
And that's one of the reasons I feel like it's important for me to tell this story, tell my story, because that was 50 years ago this year. That I spent that whole year and 2 months in Vietnam. But I landed in Vietnam January the 2nd, 1970. So I missed January the 1st because you, when you're going that way, you lose a day going over the date line. So it was exactly 50 years ago this year that I was there. Hard to believe.
Well, let's hear one more number, this time from the chapel choir.
Lie.
Thank you, Sam.